worship this day. It's good to have you with us. Special welcome to any of you that are new gathering with us for worship today. We hope that you will join us again. Our worship services are posted online Sunday mornings at 9 a.m. and Wednesday evenings at 6:15 p.m. You are welcome to join us for worship here at Sharon Lutheran anytime that you are able. A couple announcements before we begin our service. Coming up on October 11th, Sunday morning, we are going to have our annual meeting online. You'll find out more information about that in our newsletter, and some emails will be sent out. So we hope that you will join us for our annual meeting on October 11th. Also on the 11th is our centennial celebration. So we'll be having a special service that day online. We invite you to participate in that in a few different ways. One is we encourage you to send us a picture of your household worshiping at home, either a picture of where you worship in your homes or a picture with of you doing a worship with us, and then send it to us by October 7th, and we will use that picture as a part of the worship service for our centennial on the 11th. Let us pause for a moment of prayer as we prepare our hearts and our minds for worship. Please join me in the greeting with our words and our actions.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
From wherever you've been, come, Lord.
hosts and savers, rather in lands both close and distant, we confess that we are pagan. Fear has taken root in the souls of our being. Even as we turn to the parables, familiar stories that we thought we loved, we find troubling stories offering ever more questions.
Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Have mercy upon us. We are loath to take account of the many ways in which we unwittingly profit from the machinery of war and greed.
Still, we read the parables of Jesus, which fly in the face of social convention, offending those who dare to listen.
Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Have mercy upon us. Believing that we are insignificant, and at the same time fearful that we might become so, we are timid to use our voices to speak truth to a world of war.
Now the parables of Jesus offer a new vision. Now the servants dine and the masters serve. Now the last becomes first, and the first becomes last.
Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Have mercy on us.
Hear the good news of the story, that no sheep is unworthy of rescue, no coin too small to be missed. Hear the good news, that love is stronger than hate, and that this power is alive within you, now and forever. In the name of the risen Lord Jesus, I declare to you that your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Yes, joyful the morning, sinner be still. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your I'll go on.
us pray it together.
God of love, giver of life, you know our frailties and failings. Give us your grace to overcome them. Keep us from those things that harm us, and guide us in the way of salvation. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Welcome to Kids Time this week. Glad you're here as we worship together and share in the Word together. As you can see, I have a baptismal candle, and I was thinking this week about the words that are spoken when we are baptized. Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify God in heaven. I think all of us light candles. I know you do when you have a birthday cake and candles are lit and you have a chance to blow them out. Or other times, say Christmas Eve at a service and you see candles lit. We like light in the midst of this world. We have a story today about a father who asks his two sons, tells them to go into the vineyard to work. And when he tells them to go work, one of them says yes, and he doesn't do it. The other one says, no, I'm not gonna go. And then as time goes by, he decides, I've had a change of mind, and he goes to work. He does what his father told him. I want you to think this week about doing good works, that as we gather and hear the story of God, we are sent. Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify God in heaven. There's a phrase I'd invite us to remember, and it's this one this week, that it's never too late. It's never too late to be invited by God to work for God in the world. I like this son who said no. His dad asked him, go into the vineyard and work, and he said no. But then he had a change of mind, and he decided, you know what? I'm gonna do what my father asked me to do. And he did it. I don't know if you have ever had this, but maybe at home, your mom or dad have asked you, hey, would you do the dishes? Or would you pick up your room? Or would you feed the dog or the cat? Or would you take out the garbage? And maybe sometimes you say yes, and then you forget about it, you don't do it. Sometimes, I don't know if you would do this, would you say no? Oh, maybe. You maybe even at times would say no. And then you just have a change of heart and you go for it and you do it. You know what? The invitation is always there by God to go and do the right thing. And every day we're invited to let our light shine and let everybody see our works because they glorify God in heaven. Every day is a day when you can be a helper. Every day is a day when you can love someone and be kind. Every day is a day when you can look for an opportunity to bless someone. And actions speak louder than words. And every day is a day when we can begin again if we maybe have messed up. God gives us every day to have a new chance to live for Him. So think about your baptism today, that God invites us to let our light shine in this world. And I know your lights, they are shining. God bless you this week. Be God's person in the world. Amen.
first reading this morning comes from the book of Ezekiel. The word of the Lord came to me. What do you mean by repeating this proverb concerning the land of Israel? The parents have eaten sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge. As I live, says the Lord God, this proverb shall no more be used by you in Israel. Know that all lives are mine. The life of the parent, as well as the life of the child, is mine. It is only the person who sins that shall die. Yet you say the way of the Lord is unfair. Hear now, O house of Israel, is my way unfair? Is it not your ways that are unfair? When the righteous turn away from their righteousness and commit iniquity, they shall die for it. For the iniquity that they have committed, they shall die. Again, when the wicked turn away from the wickedness they have committed and do what is lawful and right, they shall save their life. Because they considered and turned away from all the transgressions that they had committed, they shall surely live. They shall not die. Yet the house of Israel says, the way of the Lord is unfair. O house of Israel, are my ways unfair? Is it not your ways that are unfair? Therefore I will judge you, O house of Israel, all of you according to your ways, says the Lord God. Repent and turn from all your transgressions, otherwise iniquity will be your ruin. Cast away from you all the transgressions that you have committed against me, and get yourselves a new heart and a new spirit. Why will you die, O house of Israel? For I have no pleasure in the death of anyone, says the Lord God. Turn then and live. The word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
This morning's gospel comes from the book of Matthew. When Jesus entered the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him as he was teaching and said, "By what authority are you doing these things, and who gave you this authority?" Jesus said to them, "I will also ask you one question. If you tell me the answer, then I will also tell you by what authority I do these things. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it of human origin?" And they argued with one another, "If we say from heaven, he will say to us, 'Why did you not believe him?' But if we say of human origin, we are afraid of the crowd, for all regard John as a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We do not know." And he said to them, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. What do you think? A man had two sons. He went to the first and said, 'Son, go and work in the vineyard today.' He answered, 'I will not,' but later he changed his mind and went. The father then went to the second and said the same, and he answered, 'I go, sir.' But he did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father?" They said, "The first." Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you, the tax collectors and prostitutes are going into the kingdom of heaven ahead of you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him. And even after you saw it, you did not change your minds and believe him." Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord. Amen. We keep at it. If this was not true, you would not be sharing in this worship service today. But there's something about Jesus that has drawn you to him. His life, his teachings, the way he has interacted with people, has drawn you close. And you've wondered about the cross and the resurrection and the power of God that is at work in the world. And at times, you've even become curious enough, is this power of God at work in my life? And at times, you catch glimpses in your own journey or in the journey of somebody else that God is up to something. And it has stirred you enough that you keep coming back to this well. You keep coming here to be fed and to be nourished and to hear the word and to wonder, what is that thread of God's life in this world and particularly in my life? It keeps me coming back. I am deeply curious about Jesus. There is something about him that has changed my life. At moments, some big turns, but often very subtly. Today, as you come, I want you to keep the phrase, "It's never too late," in your mind. Because sometimes there are circumstances in our lives where we think it's too late. It's never too late. And as we tell some stories today, just wonder about your own journey and what God is up to. I know you do this, and I do this. At least it happens at the mechanic I go to. I take my car there, and I take it for a specific thing to be fixed. And they always do a full inspection. And they check the alignment, they check the whole car, and that full inspection always makes me a bit nervous. I wonder, what are they going to find? Are they going to find more? I want to pay for my brakes today. But they do a whole look at it. And it makes me nervous, but I need it. And every time they print out that part of the vehicle inspection that talks about the alignment, and I just look at the sheet and I go, pretty good, pretty good, pretty good, a little off, pretty good, pretty good. But there have been occasions when it's really off. And something needs to be aligned. Worship and our daily coming to God is a time when we begin to trim and align our life journeys. And I don't know if you noticed it in the gospel story today. It goes very quick. But Jesus moves right to the center. If you read all of Matthew 21, and I invite you to consider doing that, Jesus comes into Jerusalem, into the holy city, and you know the story. He rides on a donkey, an animal. He parades into the city, and people shout, "Hosannas!" And they say, "Save us." They're looking to him. There's something in their lives that is a bit off, maybe really off, and needs to be fixed. And they're looking for a savior. They shout, "Hosanna, save us." And then Jesus comes into the holy city, and after he gets off of that donkey in Matthew 21, he goes into the temple, and he turns over the tables, and he chases out the buying and the selling that's going on, and he makes the place of worship a place of prayer and healing and teaching. And as he does it, he opens a space. All of a sudden, all kinds of people come into that holy space that might not otherwise come. You heard in our gospel reading today that tax collectors and prostitutes, people who are marginalized, people who are strugglers and seekers, people who have messed up and not always gotten it right, people who think it's too late are gathering around Jesus. And all of a sudden, the religious leaders of that day look around their temple where they're comfortable, and they wonder, who is he to gather all these people? Who is Jesus to speak with authority and to act with authority? And they start to wonder about that and ask some questions. And yet even they know that something very sacred, special, holy, disturbing is happening. People are beginning to center their lives in him, align their lives to Jesus. You and I have discovered this at times in our own journey. Even we've been in so much pain that we went looking for Jesus, or we've had a moment of mystery in our lives where we've been drawn to Jesus, but in some way we just begin to center our lives in him. We're invited deeper into his life. And it's never too late for that to happen. I was thinking of a story of a friend of mine years ago, as I got to know him when I served a congregation in his area. He was a gentleman who was very successful, and he had grown up in a German Lutheran congregation, and his family had just been involved in the church, their way of life centered around the life of a congregation. He went to parochial school. He served projects in the church, and the rhythm of their life was Sunday and Wednesday, daily prayers at home, and then he was old enough to leave home. And he just started this very successful career, and everything just looked, well, probably like he imagined it to be. And then one week in December, when his son was about 7 or 8 years old, his son, in a very honest, curious way, came up to him in the living room and said, "Dad, who is Jesus?" And His dad paused for a moment and said, "Why do you ask? And what's going on? What are you thinking?" And he goes, "Well, Christmas is coming up." And he explained that he had heard others talking about Jesus and, "Well, Dad, who is Jesus?" And all of a sudden, his dad was stunned. He thought, "I've never introduced my son to the faith." Here he is, he had grown up in it himself, and off he went, and all of a sudden he has a family, and here is his son asking a holy question. So this was in the days of phone books. His dad went to a phone book after that conversation, after it unsettled him, and he looked in the phone book and he found the nearest church to their home. It happened to be the one that I was serving, and looked it up and called the church, got the times of the Christmas Eve services, and for the first time in his kids' lives, they went to church, found their way into the pew. I didn't know this story at all until sometime later, but it is a story about it's never too late. All of a sudden, a holy moment showed up in their lives through his son, who was just asking an honest question, and a very successful gentleman realizing there are other parts to my life. And all of a sudden, they started to involve themselves in the life of God in a new way. They had an incredible story in this way, in that off they went on an adventure. I had the privilege of just watching how their family was transformed and how they had a new beginning in seeking the ways of God in their life. No judgment on their story. It was just their time, the right time, a Kairos moment, God's time, when it was meant to just flourish. Well, we hear this gospel story today about a father who says to two sons, "Go work in the vineyard." You know the story. We mentioned it during children's time. One of the sons says yes, and then we're not sure what happened, but he just doesn't go. Happens all the time. I've done it. I've said yes and then just kind of drifted. The other son, I don't know what was going on with him that day, but his dad said, "Go work in the vineyard," and he had the whatever he had going in him, he said, "No, not going to do it." But then he changed his mind after some time, and he went, and he did the work his father asked him to do. Jesus asks the question, which one did the will of the father? Jesus, how is a good question asker? And turns out to be the son that changed his mind. Was a little late, but he did it. He had a change of heart. You get inside the scripture, it might even mean that he had a change in what he cared about. And it happens when we start to align. When Jesus pushes himself front and center in our lives, what we care about can change and be transformed. We think about our baptismal journeys from time to time. Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works. And we have the opportunity, as we center our lives in Jesus, as we hear the word and are nourished in it, to begin to live the word in our daily life, to live out where God calls us. And every time we worship, it is an invitation to begin to get on the right track. And it's never too late for this to happen. There's a story about told by the late Joseph Sittler. He was a Lutheran teacher, and he tells a story about visiting Israel, and he rented a vehicle, and he drove around Jerusalem, evidently. I mean, I can't imagine driving around Jerusalem. And while he was there, the car went through some bumpy roads, or it was just, something was not right, and he took it to a mechanic. And the mechanic worked on the car for quite some time, and Joseph left, and he came back, and the mechanic was done. and he heard the mechanic say the word Sadak. And Joseph Sittler, very bright theologian, thought in his mind that word means righteous. And he'd driven the car in such a way that it just wasn't in alignment, and it was just, it needed help. And the mechanic, when he got done, all of a sudden said the word Sadak, righteous, or which meant it was aligned. It could now travel again smoothly. And Sittler never forgot it and told that story again and again. When we open our lives to God, God goes to work. We often talk about it's all about love, and it is all about love. But when we get too close to Jesus and we want to be close to him, we're curious about him, something happens. It's about an event. It's about the cross and the resurrection. It's about the authority of Jesus authoring something new in our lives. It is about the old Adam and the old Eve dying and our lives being joined to a power that puts us on a path we might not otherwise have gotten on unless God had met us in Christ. There's something I know about you because I know about people. Your journey is important. And sometimes on your journey, you have thought to yourself, depending on what the circumstance is, it's too late. You maybe feel like you've missed an opportunity. Or if you could have done things differently, you would sure do them differently again if you got a second chance and you think it's gone. And here's the thing about God who meets us in Jesus. When he comes into Jerusalem, when he cleanses the temple, when he pushes himself to the center and gets everybody's attention, when he dies on the cross and when he rises, and when we draw closer to him, we hear the promise, it is never too late. This is grace. This is our rising. This is the power of God. It is what it means when Jesus has authority in our journeys. It means he helps us author a new beginning. Well, the person I told you about, when his son came and asked him, who is Jesus? They started coming to church. He started, I guess, for the first time in a long time, really engaging his faith. He went from building buildings in a construction industry to thinking, I want to work for God. He started building churches, literally, build church buildings. And then he kept getting more deeper into where God was working in his life, and all of a sudden, he enrolled in seminary, and then now he's an ELCA pastor. And from the outside, looking in, I just thought, what a journey. But it all started with a little boy coming to his dad and saying, hey, Dad, I heard a friend talk about Christmas. Who is this Jesus? And there's something about that question that took him somewhere. Jesus is great at asking questions. He might even be asking you a question this week that you are puzzling over. You're wondering about your own life journey in some way, shape, or form. Whatever that looks like, if you have that part of you that thinks things are too late, think about the son who said no to his father. And then all of a sudden, mysteriously, he had a change of heart in what he cared about, and it started to align differently because the power of God was at work in his life. Sometimes I have doubted very passionately that the power of God was at work in my life or in this world. I have even kind of wrestled with God on that one or tried to walk away. But I've discovered that this Jesus has a way of just pushing himself to the center of our lives, and it is grace. So if this is you this week, know that God authors new beginnings and we can always discover the surprise that our lives can align to this one who leads us forward. Amen.
This time we pause for our morning's offering. We consider the gifts that God has given us and give thanks to God by giving our offerings in return. We invite you to go to our church website. You'll find a link there that you can give online. Or if you have offering envelopes, you can mail your offering into our church office here at Sharon or drop it off here at the building. If you are a member of another congregation, we encourage you to consider giving to their ministry as well. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, maker of all things. You have set before us these gifts of your good creation. We thank you for your love and your grace, and your peace and your hope and life. Nourish us with your food and your drink. Nourish us with your love and send us forth to share your gifts with others. Through the bread of life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
We know.
Drawn together in the compassion of God, we pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. In all the world, give your church unity. Inspire all the baptized with the mind of Christ. Where the church is powerful and where it struggles, shape us with humility and obedience so that your love may be at work in us. Open our ears to hear your call and give us the courage to follow. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Your Son took on all of bodily life in our world, even to death. Preserve and keep your creation, O God. Mend and redeem places that are polluted and damaged. Bring relief to those places affected by hurricanes, as well as the West Coast, where fires ravage homes, businesses, and the land. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Turn the nations toward life. Where our ways are unfair, give us new hearts and new spirits. Where the sin of racism affects our culture and institutions, open our hearts and change our minds that we might see that you love all people and call us to love one another as you have loved us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for family and friends, for their health and safety for those who travel. Our lives are yours, O God. Relieve the sufferings of those who are ill in body, mind, or spirit, especially Gary, Burnell, Ron, Ginger, Carolyn, Kevin, Phoebe, Allison, and others we name before you. Defend the lives and welfare of children who are abused or neglected, hungry or exploited, bullied or lonely. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Turn this congregation away from our own interests and toward the interests of others. Fill us with your compassion and sympathy. Bless ministries of care in our community and congregation. And make us into signs of your mercy and justice for our neighbors. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Thank you for those who have gone into the kingdom ahead of us. Tax collectors and prostitutes, likely and unlikely, obedient and slow to learn. By their witness, teach us to confess Jesus Christ as Lord in our life and in our death. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
All these things and whatever else you see that we need, we entrust to your mercy through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
pray together.
O God, you have called your servants to ventures of which we cannot see the ending, by paths as yet untrodden, through perils unknown. Give us faith to go out with good courage, not knowing where we go, but only that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Receive the Lord's blessing. O Mother and God, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever, and lead you into the way of truth and life. Amen. Go in peace, wear your masks, social distance, wash your hands, and love your neighbors. And remember that you are not alone.
We will. Thanks be to God.